There is a forbidden book, lost for centuries, that includes fallen angels, bloodthirsty giants, and a warning to all humanity. It is an ancient writing filled with divine secrets, dreams, and visions. A tour of heaven and hell, guided by the angel Uriel. The Book of Enoch is named for the man who the Holy Bible says walked with God.
Enoch walked with God after the birth of Methuselah 300 years, and had other sons and daughters. Thus all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Enoch walked with God, then he was no more because God took him.
It is a daunting manuscript. 5 volumes containing 108 chapters. For many ancient Christians, the Book of Enoch was essential. Yet it was banned from the Christian Bible.
We don't know why this literature was ultimately excluded from the canon. Perhaps it's because of its description of the fall of the rebel angels and their mating with mortals. Perhaps its understanding of the end of time fell out of favor with Jews and Christians.
The Book of Enoch begins with a warning to all humanity that a divine judgment has been rendered and a sentence will be imposed. God tells Enoch that all life on earth will be destroyed in a violent flood, and, as with the story in Genesis, God blames this evil on the sons of God, angels who lusted after the daughters of men.
These angels are sometimes referred to as watchers. They keep constant watch, and they decide one day, about 200 of them, that they're going to descend to the earth. They would like to very much make contact with these mortal women.
The Book of Enoch may have been an attempt to expand on the mysterious giants, the sons of God, and the daughters of the earth, spoken of in Genesis.
Anytime you read the book of Genesis, there are all kinds of unanswered questions. Suddenly, there is this quick few verses at the beginning of the flood story about giants in the land that come from the sons of God mixing with the daughters of the earth. And you stop and think, wait a minute, what's this all about? It's like it went by too fast. And you want to grab it and say, wait a minute, what was this?
The Book of Enoch offers a disturbing vision of the fall of the angels who lust after earthly women.
And they began to go into them and to defile themselves with them, and they taught them charms and enchantments. And they became pregnant, and they bare great giants whose height was 3,000 ells. And when men could no longer sustain them, the giants turned against them and devoured mankind.
That these angels have crossed over this boundary that they shouldn't have. They were spiritual beings and they were to remain as such. When they decided to descend upon earth, this unleashed upon the earth all sorts of problems. Not only these giants who are bloodthirsty and violent, but also these angels went on to teach humankind a variety of forbidden crafts. They also taught human beings how to make weapons of war.
Now, the good angels, the ones not tempted by these beautiful women, go to God and say, you know, there's a lot of bloodshed caused by these bad angels. At which point God says, we need to bind Azazel, the sort of lead fallen angel, to bind him and to then cast him into a pit. We might think of this as, how do we take care of nuclear waste in the 21st century? You take it out to a part of the world where no one lives, and you bury it as deep as you can. For this community, the angel was like that sort of nuclear waste. Dangerous, volatile.
After the rebel angels are cast into the depths of the earth, Enoch has a dream vision. The lead angel, Azazel, begs Enoch to plead their case before God, to petition the Almighty to release them from the depths of the earth. The request for clemency is denied.
This version of the fall of the angels was very popular in its day and maintained popularity for centuries to come. When we look at Dante's work on the Inferno, it's largely out of the material in Enoch. When we look at various snips of the New Testament, Enoch seems to be in play. In Corinthians, when Paul talks about women covering their hair so the angels won't be seduced and tempted, it goes back to the fallen angels tradition.
Another episode tells of Uriel, a powerful angel in charge of the stars, who becomes Enoch's guide through the heavenly realms.
Uriel's name, in fact, means God is my light. And whenever he is described frequently in relation to God, he is situated to the east of God's throne. This is very interesting. Of course, the sun rises to the east. So this gets us thinking, Uriel, a figure associated with light, perhaps associated in some way with the sun or the stars, or the idea of these heavenly bodies making their rotations daily.
And all these Uriel, the holy angel, who is the leader of them all, showed to me, and their positions, and I wrote down their positions as he showed them to me.
With its lush descriptions of heavenly powers and the horrors that await evildoers, even angels, Enoch was one of the most popular books among the early Christians.
We know that some early Christians considered the writings of Enoch to be authoritative, to contain actual revelation from God. So, because some people thought that, some influential people thought that, the book was used as you would use other books of the Bible.
After all, revelation appears in the New Testament. But Enoch, for reasons that I think are fairly clear, was just considered a little too strange, a little too suspicious, a little too creative, perhaps, for the tradition. Having said that, there's no doubt that it was widely read and very popular.
Yet the Book of Enoch was denied a home in the official Christian canon. This imaginative tale fell into obscurity until the late 18th century, when a Scottish explorer named James Bruce came upon this mysterious text in Aksum, a city in the Ethiopian highlands.
Travelers to Ethiopia found manuscripts of these books and brought them back to Europe. This caused quite a sensation. I'm aware of scholarly reaction to them. People were excited about having these texts that we knew about only through allusion before this time, or a brief quotation. Whether this raised any questions in people's minds, canonical questions, should we put these books in the Bible? I'm not aware of really intense discussions of that sort.
Until the mid-20th century, the Book of Enoch was assumed to be of interest only to the very early Christians. We now know that Enoch was sacred to Ethiopian Christians all along.
Part of the reason why this probably became part of their canon is because of the mythic story of the foundation of the Ethiopian monarchy. You have Sheba who goes to see King Solomon, and the story goes that not only does she bring gifts, she brings a little bit of something back home. She's pregnant with Solomon's son. That son is Menelik. Menelik is the first dynastic king of Ethiopia. He actually goes back and retrieves the Ark of the Covenant from Solomon because Solomon is not taking care of the kingdom properly. And the Ark rests reportedly in Aksum in Ethiopia. So when Christianity comes later in about the 4th century to Ethiopia, there's already a story there. There's already a connection to the Old Testament story. So the Book of Enoch and all all these other types of books that are included within the Ethiopian canon become part and parcel of putting together this Old Testament story, this Old Testament link, with a very new Christianity that enters into the Ethiopian. They don't give up the old. They put it all together with the new and blend it together.
Large portions of the Book of Enoch also were found among the Essene literature, hidden in the caves of Qumran, as part of the Dead Sea Scrolls.
What about when Joshua and the nation of Israel entered the land of Canaan? They were instructed to wipe out every man, woman, and child of certain tribes. I've talked to some people whose entire rejection of the Bible and God rests on this portion of the biblical text. This video is for those people. What no one ever mentions when recounting this issue is that according to the story itself, the tribes that they killed were non-human hybrids called the Nephilim, and they were huge. They had iron beds 13 feet long and 6 feet wide. It says that the Israelites were like grasshoppers in the sight of the Canaanites. These Nephilim were the offspring of very evil spiritual beings, and they were apparently the primary reason God sent the flood. Satan knew of the prophecies of one that would come to defeat him, and before any of the prophets came to expand on how this was to occur, all he knew at that point was that the Messiah would be a human. The Nephilim were an attempt to infiltrate the entire bloodline of humanity so that the Messiah could not be a full-blooded man, and if it weren't for Noah and his family, it would have worked. Then when Abraham found out from God that the land of Canaan was to be given to Abraham, Satan also found out, and he had over 400 years to plant this minefield of Nephilim in the land of Canaan in an attempt to thwart the plan of God. Genesis 6:4 tells us that the Nephilim were also on the earth after the flood, and it is them who Joshua was told to wipe out. Tribes such as the Rephaim, the Emim, the Horim, the Zamzumim were all giants. The kingdom of Og was the land of the giants. Later, we also find Arba and Anak and his seven sons, the Anakim, also giants, along with the famed Goliath and his four brothers.
The Book of Enoch is a highly controversial and convoluted subject, enveloped in a dizzying haze of Ethiopian tradition, occultic mythology, esoteric mysticism, and uneducated assumption. The personage of Enoch himself is ambiguous at best, leading many people to conjure up wild speculations concerning who he was, where he went, and what exactly he wrote. Though the Bible reveals very little about Enoch, the writer of the book of Jude boldly quotes verbatim from one of the works ascribed to him, a quote which is referenced as prophecy no less. It is therefore logical to infer that Enoch is in fact responsible for some literary work. The question is, which of the many writings attributed to him is the real McCoy? In Genesis 5 we read, Enoch lived 65 years and begot Methuselah. After he begot Methuselah, Enoch walked with God 300 years and had sons and daughters. So all the days of Enoch were 365 years. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Aside from a few more cursory references, the Bible doesn't really tell us any more about Enoch, even though he was obviously an extraordinary individual, extremely pleasing to God. Could the reason for the Bible's ambiguity concerning Enoch be due to the fact that his story was already thoroughly chronicled elsewhere in Scripture? This seems likely. If Enoch, the seventh from Adam, is indeed the author of a book, it would have been written long before the book of Genesis, which is generally thought to have been penned by Moses, or by an anonymous author after Moses. The writer of the book of Genesis, whoever he was, would have had no need to retell the story of Enoch, had it been already recorded in detail and widely disseminated, especially if it were written by Enoch's own hand. It is plausible, then, that the Book of Enoch may have provided the foundation for much of the narrative of not only the Book of Genesis, but the entire Bible, both Old and New Testament, and may well be the very first, certainly the very earliest, record of human literature. With that in mind, let's analyze the Book of Enoch. Many people do not know that there are actually three versions of the Book of Enoch, further complicating the situation. However, a mere peripheral examination of these three versions promptly reveals which one is most credible and worthy of consideration. First Enoch, otherwise known as the Ethiopic Enoch, was indisputably written long before the birth of Christ. Most scholars agree that it dates from at least 300 BC, if not much earlier. The content of First Enoch is Christ-centric. It discloses more detailed prophetic revelation concerning the Son of Man than any other known BC manuscript, including those of the Old Testament. Second Enoch, otherwise known as the Slavonic Enoch, also called the Book of the Secrets of Enoch, is most commonly dated after the birth of Christ, in the latter part of the first century AD. The content of Second Enoch is theologically Judaic in nature, rather than Christian. Third Enoch, otherwise known as the Hebrew Enoch, also called the Revelation of Metatron, was definitely written after the birth of Christ. Most scholars place it between 500 and 600 AD. The content of Third Enoch is highly esoteric. It accounts a mystical journey to heaven involving Rabbi Ishmael ben Elisha, the high priest. In light of this information, it is apparent that the most credible version of the Book of Enoch is unquestionably First Enoch, since it was written long before the birth of Christ and contains prophetic revelation concerning him. Because of this, we can decisively confirm or deny the validity of First Enoch based on the accuracy of its prophetic revelation and the doctrine of its theological content, juxtaposed with the teachings of Jesus and his disciples. But before we examine the text of First Enoch, it is beneficial to review its historical background. In 1773, the famous Scottish explorer James Bruce returned to Europe after 6 years in Abyssinia, or Ethiopia as we know it today, bearing with him three complete copies of the Gies, or Ethiopic version of First Enoch. The Ethiopic Christians had preserved the Book of Enoch from the early church era of the first century, and having translated it into their native language, inducted it into the canon of their church. In 1948, 14 fragments of the Book of Enoch, First Enoch, were discovered in the caves of Qumran among the Dead Sea Scrolls. 11 of the fragments were written in ancient Aramaic and 3 in ancient Hebrew. Paradoxically, there exists a well-preserved ancient Aramaic scroll of the complete Book of Enoch, which has never been published and is privately owned. Though the scroll has been carefully concealed from the eyes of the public, the former chief editor of the official Dead Sea Scrolls editorial team, John Strugnell, who died in 2007, was shown the microfilm of the scroll in 1990 during the Kuwait crisis. Gerald Lancaster Harding, director of Jordan's Department of Antiquities from 1936 to 1956, also testified to having seen the microfilm of the scroll. Whether or not the Book of Enoch is in fact the very first record of human literature is obviously debatable. However, its prominence and circulation in both the ancient world and the early church era is irrefutable. There is little doubt among scholars that First Enoch was influential in molding New Testament doctrines about the Messiah, the Son of Man, the Messianic Kingdom, demonology, the resurrection, and eschatology. The Greek text was also known to and referenced by many of the early church fathers, including Clement and Barnabas, who were friends of Paul, Tertullian, Athenagoras of Athens, Irenaeus, Origen, and Justin Martyr, to name a few. In a second century work on the apparel of women, Tertullian writes the following: I am aware that the scripture of Enoch, which has assigned this order of action to angels, referring to their intercourse with women in Genesis 6, is not received by some, because it is not admitted into the Jewish canon either. I suppose they did not think that, having been published before the deluge, it could have safely survived that worldwide calamity, the abolisher of all things. If that is the reason for rejecting it, let them recall to their memory that Noah, the survivor of the deluge, was the great-grandson of Enoch himself, and he, of course, had heard and remembered from domestic renown and hereditary tradition concerning his own great-grandfather's grace in the sight of God, and concerning all his preachings, since Enoch had given no other charge to Methuselah than that he should hand down the knowledge of them to his posterity, Noah, therefore, no doubt, might have succeeded in the trusteeship of his preaching, or, had the case been otherwise, he would not have been silent alike concerning the disposition of things made by God, his preserver, and concerning the particular glory of his own house. If Noah had not had this conservative power by so short a route, there would still be this consideration to warrant our assertion of the genuineness of this scripture. He could equally have renewed it under the Spirit's inspiration after it had been destroyed by the violence of the deluge, as after the destruction of Jerusalem by the Babylonian storming of it, every document of the Jewish literature is generally agreed to have been restored through Ezra. But since Enoch in the same scripture has preached likewise concerning the Lord, nothing at all must be rejected by us which pertains to us. And we read that every scripture suitable for edification is divinely inspired. By the Jews, it may now seem to have been rejected for that very reason, just like all the other portions nearly which tell of Christ. Nor, of course, is this fact wonderful, that they did not receive some scriptures which spake of him, whom even in person, speaking in their presence, they were not to receive. To these considerations is added the fact that Enoch possesses a testimony in the Apostle Jude. Indeed, the writer of the book of Jude, as mentioned earlier, boldly quotes verbatim from the book of Enoch in the context of prophecy. Now Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men also, saying, "Behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment on all, to convict all who are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have committed in an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him." Nevertheless, by 500 AD, despite widespread popularity and endorsement by many early church personalities, the Book of Enoch was virtually purged from the face of the earth at the hands of the satanic priesthood of the Roman Catholic Church. It is no wonder, as Tertullian suggests, that the Book of Enoch was rejected by the non-Messianic Jews and not admitted into their canon. Having rejected Jesus Christ, they could never have accepted as Holy Scripture a text which so boldly testified of him long before his coming. The Book of Enoch, perhaps the very first book ever written by the hand of a human being, proclaims the undisputed lordship of the Son of Man and prophesies with articulate clarity his millennial reign at the end of the age, in accordance with Jesus' own words and the teachings of the apostles. Before all other known manuscripts, the Book of Enoch designates the coming Messiah as the Anointed One, the Righteous One, the Elect One, and the Son of Man. The term Son of Man is an explicit title, not a descriptor, and the one that Jesus most often used when referring to himself. And yet this term, employed as an explicit title, is nowhere to be found in the pages of the Old Testament, except perhaps on one occasion in the book of Daniel. However, it is the dominant title designated for the Messiah in the book of Enoch. When Jesus claimed to be the Son of Man, he was not saying that he was merely a Son of Man, but the Son of Man. What is the determining factor for inspired prophetic text, if not the testimony of Jesus Christ? We know that the whole Bible, cover to cover, testifies of Jesus, the Son of God, even in ways we haven't yet figured out, and is verified by the very truth of its testimony. Those who have blindly condemned the Book of Enoch without reading it, or weighing its content in the balance of the gospel, may be surprised to discover that the revelation of Jesus Christ is the centerpiece of its message. A message which is addressed to the elect and righteous who will be living in the day of tribulation, when all the wicked and godless are to be removed. Now, regardless of mine or anyone else's opinion, the Book of Enoch must be judged on the merit of its messianic content. A cursory review of some of its pages quickly discloses the nature of that content. Keep in mind as we review these excerpts that this text predates the birth of Christ and all of the New Testament epistles, and remember the words spoken to John from the lips of the mighty angel in Revelation 19. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. And in that place mine eyes saw the elect one of righteousness and faith. And I saw his dwelling place under the wings of the Lord of the spirits. And righteousness shall prevail in his days, and the righteous and elect shall be without number before him, for ever and ever. And I heard the voices of those four presences as they uttered praises before the Lord of glory. The first voice blesses the Lord of the spirits for ever and ever. And the second voice I heard blessing the elect one and the elect ones who hang upon the Lord of the spirits. On that day, mine elect ones shall sit on the throne of glory and shall try their works, and their places of rest shall be innumerable, and their souls shall grow strong within them when they see mine elect ones and those who have called upon my glorious name. Then I will cause mine elect one to dwell among them, and I will transform the heaven and make it an eternal blessing and light. And I will transform the earth and make it a blessing, and I will cause mine elect ones to dwell upon it. And there I saw one who had a head of days, and his head was white like wool. And with him was another being whose countenance had the appearance of a man, and his face was full of graciousness, like one of the holy angels. And I asked the angel who went with me, and showed me all the hidden things concerning that Son of Man, who he was, and whence he was, and why he went with the head of days. And he answered and said unto me, This is the Son of Man who hath righteousness, with whom dwelleth righteousness, and who revealeth all the treasures of that which is hidden, because the Lord of the spirits hath chosen him, and whose lot hath the preeminence before the Lord of the spirits in uprightness forever. And this Son of Man, whom thou hast seen, shall raise up the kings and the mighty from their seats, and the strong from their thrones, and shall loosen the reins of the strong, and break the teeth of sinners. And he shall put down the kings from their thrones and kingdoms, because they do not extol and praise him, nor humbly acknowledge whence the kingdom was bestowed upon them. And at that hour that Son of Man was named in the presence of the Lord of the spirits, and his name before the head of days, yea, before the sun and the signs were created, before the stars of the heaven were made, his name was named before the Lord of the spirits. And he shall be a staff to the righteous whereon to stay themselves and not fall. And he shall be the light of the Gentiles and the hope of those who are troubled of heart. All who dwell on the earth shall fall down and worship before him, and will praise and bless and celebrate with song the Lord of the spirits. And for this reason hath he been chosen and hidden before him, before the creation of the world and forevermore. And the wisdom of the Lord of the spirits hath revealed him to the holy and righteous. For he hath preserved the lot of the righteous, because they have hated and despised this world of unrighteousness, and have hated all its works and ways in the name of the Lord of the spirits. For in his name they are saved, and according to his good pleasure hath it been in regard to their life. For wisdom is poured out like water, and glory faileth not before him for evermore. For he is mighty in all the secrets of righteousness, and unrighteousness shall disappear as a shadow, and have no continuance, because the elect one standeth before the Lord of the spirits. And his glory is for ever and ever, and his might unto all generations. And in him dwells the spirit of wisdom, and the spirit which gives insight, and the spirit of understanding and of might, and the spirit of those who have fallen asleep in righteousness. And he shall judge the secret things, and none shall be able to utter a lying word before him. For he is the elect one before the Lord of the spirits, according to his good pleasure. And in those days shall the earth also give back that which has been entrusted to it, and shed also give back that which it has received, and hell shall give back that which it owes. For in those days the elect one shall arise, and he shall choose the righteous and holy from among them, for the day has drawn nigh that they should be saved. And the elect one shall in those days sit on my throne, and his mouth shall pour forth all the secrets of wisdom and counsel, for the Lord of the spirits hath given them to him, and hath glorified him. And thus the Lord commanded the kings and the mighty and the exalted, and those who dwell on the earth, and said, Open your eyes and lift up your horns, if ye are able to recognize the elect one. And the Lord of the Spirit seated him on the throne of his glory, and the Spirit of righteousness was poured out upon him, and the word of his mouth slays all the sinners. And they shall be terrified, and they shall be downcast of countenance, and pain shall seize them when they see that Son of Man sitting on the throne of his glory. And the kings and the mighty and all who possess the earth shall bless and glorify and extol him who rules over all who was hidden. For from the beginning the Son of Man was hidden, and the Most High preserved him in the presence of his might, and revealed him to the elect. And the congregation of the elect and the holy shall be sown. And all the elect shall stand before him on that day, and all the kings and the mighty and the exalted and those who rule the earth shall fall down before him on their faces, and worship and set their hope upon that Son of Man, and petition him and supplicate for mercy at his hands. And the righteous and elect shall be saved on that day, and they shall never thenceforward see the face of sinners and unrighteous. And the Lord of the spirits will abide over them, and with that Son of Man shall they eat, and lie down, and rise up for ever and ever. And there was great joy amongst them, and they blessed and glorified and extolled, because the name of that Son of Man had been revealed unto them. And he sat on the throne of his glory, and some of judgment was given unto the Son of Man, and he caused the sinners to pass away and be destroyed from off the face of the earth, and those who have led the world astray. With chains they shall be bound, and in their assemblage place of destruction shall they be imprisoned, and all their works vanish from the face of the earth. And from henceforth there shall be nothing corruptible, for that Son of Man has appeared, and has seated himself on the throne of his glory, and all evil shall pass away before his face, and the word of that Son of Man shall go forth and be strong before the Lord of the spirits. And finally, Enoch saw the Son of Man walking in heaven with the head of days, and asked one of the angels concerning him. And he, the angel, came to me and greeted me with his voice, and said unto me, This is the Son of Man who is born unto righteousness, and righteousness abides over him, and the righteousness of the head of days forsakes him not. And he said unto me, He proclaims unto thee peace in the name of the world to come, and for from hence has proceeded peace since the creation of the world, and so shall it be unto thee for ever and for ever and ever. And all shall walk in his ways, since righteousness never forsakes him. With him will be their dwelling places, and with him their heritage. And they shall not be separated from him for ever and ever and ever. And so there shall be length of days with that Son of Man, and the righteous shall have peace and an upright way, in the name of the Lord of the spirits, for ever and ever. Again I quote the words of Tertullian. But since Enoch in the same scripture has preached likewise concerning the Lord, nothing at all must be rejected by us which pertains to us. The argument of whether or not the Book of Enoch should be canonized and included in the Bible is irrelevant. The only question we should be asking is whether or not the Book of Enoch is true. Could it be that we are the generation who will be living in the day of tribulation, when all the wicked and godless are to be removed? If so, then the Book of Enoch, written in the dawn of humanity, is addressed to us who are living in the twilight. I'm Timothy Alberino, and that's my analysis. In 1947, a Bedouin boy was traversing the cliffs along the Dead Sea in Israel's Judean desert, searching for a stray goat. As legend has it, he happened upon a cave burrowed into the face of the limestone. Provoked by curiosity and divine providence, the boy cast a stone into the mouth of the cave. But rather than falling to the arid ground with a thud, as he expected, the stone struck something altogether unexpected, as the unmistakable sound of shattering pottery rang in the air. Upon entering the cave to investigate the source of the sound, this young Bedouin goat herder made what was to become one of the greatest archaeological discoveries of all time. Stowed within large earthen jars were rolls of ancient parchment, the Dead Sea Scrolls. 10 more caves would be discovered in subsequent years, containing many more manuscripts and archaeological artifacts. The Dead Sea Scrolls are a collection of some 981 texts discovered between 1946 and 1956 in the caves of Qumran. The texts, written in Hebrew, Aramaic, Greek, and Nabataean, are inscribed predominantly on parchment, but also on papyrus and bronze. Due to the poor condition of some of the manuscripts, not all of them have been identified, and only fragments of some of them remain. Among the Dead Sea Scrolls are numerous copies of every book in the Hebrew Bible and the Old Testament Protocanon, except the Book of Esther. Many apocryphal works are also present, such as the Book of Jubilees, the Genesis Apocryphon, the Book of Noah, the Book of Enoch, and the Book of Giants, all of which were found together in Cave 1 of Qumran. The Book of Giants, composed in Aramaic, is dated with certainty to at least the 2nd century BC, if not much earlier. The content of the manuscript, though severely fragmented, expounds on the narrative of the Book of Enoch concerning the fall of the angelic watchers, their malevolent hybrid offspring, and the great flood that ensued as a result. This particular narrative is not exclusive to the Book of Enoch, but is referenced extensively throughout the Bible in both the Old and New Testament, as well as in many of the apocryphal works, including the books of Jasher and Jubilees, and can be traced throughout the written and oral tradition of every major ancient civilization on the planet. Because the manuscript is eroded and fragmented, its exact contents and their order are uncertain. Nevertheless, much can be deduced from what remains. The Book of Giants describes in detail how the fallen angels insidiously corrupted the genetics of all flesh on the earth. It tells us specifically that 200 donkeys, 200 asses, 200 rams of the flock, 200 goats, 200 beasts of the field, from every animal, from every bird, were selected for miscegenation. The word miscegenation refers to the mixing of races or species, particularly in the context of sexual intercourse. The text that follows makes it abundantly clear that this was no mere act of interspecies breeding, but instead extreme cross-species genetics involving the seed of the angels themselves. They defiled, they begot giants and monsters, they begot, and behold, all the earth was corrupted. It is important to note that not only were giants begotten of the fallen angels, but also monsters. According to the text, giants and monsters are two very distinct designations. Scripture validates that when angels inseminate human women, giant angel-human hybrid beings are generated. We can infer then that when angels inseminate animals, monstrous angel-animal hybrid beings are generated, varying in appearance according to their respective species. These hybrid monsters could very well have been sentient, conscious, with the ability to think and reason like us, at least in some cases, probably dependent on the degree of angelic genetic markers present in their genomes. In fact, the notions of sentience among the hybrid monsters seems to be presupposed in a particular section of the manuscript. Thereupon two of them had dreams, and the sleep of their eyes fled from them. And they arose, and came to, and told their dreams, and said in the assembly of their comrades, the monsters. This text assumes that at least some of the monsters were sentient, because they could hear and understand the words of their comrades, the giants, and presumably speak in their language. Although these monsters were in a sense the stepbrothers of the giants, having the same fathers, they seemed to be of an inferior caste. Whereas their fathers were angelic watchers, their mothers were literally beasts, We can therefore infer that their intellectual capacity was less than that of the giants who were born of human mothers. Furthermore, both the Book of Enoch and the Book of Giants exclusively designates the giants as the children of the angels. The angel-animal hybrid monsters seem to be regarded as offspring, but not direct descendants like the giants. The Book of Enoch and the Book of Giants reveals the particular affection that the Watchers had for their human hybrid children. And inasmuch as they, the Watchers, delight themselves in their children, the giants, the murder of their beloved ones shall they see, and over the destruction of their children shall they lament, and shall make supplication unto eternity. The children of angels are the giants, and they would not let all their loved ones be neglected. Another interesting anecdote in the text is a reference to at least one of the giants having the capability of flight, which is demonstrated when Makwe, son of the watcher Barakel, journeys to consult with Enoch. He mounted up in the air like strong winds and flew with his hands like eagles. He left behind the inhabited world and passed over desolation, the great desert. The phrase, flew with his hands like eagles, could be literal, and that some of the giants might have inherited an innate supernatural ability to travel through the air like their angelic fathers. Alternatively, it might be an allegorical reference to a technology not understood by the writer. This kind of rhetorical device is common when uneducated minds attempt to describe advanced technological concepts such as aeronautics and aerospace craft. The Book of Enoch emphasizes the fact that the Watchers taught their hybrid children the secrets of heaven, which included what we would call advanced physics, mathematics, chemistry, astrology, etc. Hence, the idea that the giants would be capable of manufacturing and operating advanced technology is certainly supported in the narrative. The primary theme and bulk of the content from the Book of Giants concerns a series of ominous dreams and visions that were troubling the Titan sons of the Watchers, portents of imminent judgment. Makwe reports the first of these dreams to his fellow giants. He sees a tablet inscribed with many names being immersed in water. When it emerges, all but three names have been washed away. The dream evidently symbolizes the destruction of all but Noah and his two sons and the great flood. The following is a brief summary of the story recounted in the Book of Giants, based on the legible fragments that have been reconstructed and supplemented by the Book of the Watchers and First Enoch. 200 angelic beings called Watchers made a pact to defy God and descended to the earth in the days of Jared. They took human women as wives and had sexual intercourse with them. Their wives gave birth to hybrid giants. The Watchers taught their wives and children the secrets of heaven, and the human race was beguiled by the forbidden knowledge. The giants began to rule over the inhabitants of the earth. The Watchers chose animals from diverse species, 200 of each kind, in order to copulate with them and progenerate genetic aberrations. The animals conceived hybrid monsters according to their respective species. Nearly all life on the planet became genetically corrupted and flesh-eating. The giants and the monsters terrorized the earth and devoured the human race. The giants began to have foreboding dreams and visions that deeply troubled them. They decided to seek out Enoch to interpret the dreams. Enoch presents them with a copy of the tablet addressed to the Watchers, pronouncing a terrible judgment from God upon them, their wives, and their children. The giants are in denial concerning their inevitable fate. The Watchers come to the assembly of their offspring, and with great sorrow and weeping, verify the terrible judgment written on the tablet. The giants, enticed by an angel of heaven, make war with one another and annihilate themselves. The Watchers are bound by the angels of heaven and imprisoned in the abyss. A great flood destroys all life on earth, except Noah, his two sons, and their wives. The book of Genesis, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, 2 Samuel, 1 Chronicles, Isaiah, Daniel, Amos, 2 Peter, Jude, the book of Jubilees, the book of Jasher, the Genesis Apocryphon, the book of Noah, the book of Enoch, and many more ancient writings besides, along with the oral tradition of every prime civilization on this planet, confirm the story I just outlined from the Book of Giants. At this point in history, only willful ignorance denies it.
Dr. I.D.E. Thomas is one of a long line of Welsh preachers. He is currently the senior pastor at the First Baptist Church of Maywood, California, and has authored several books which have enjoyed wide circulation. In his book, The Omega Conspiracy, Dr. Thomas explains the phenomenon of unidentified flying objects and offers an explanation that could identify the beings who operate them. As incredible as his explanation may sound, let us regard the ancient saying of Heraclitus, who 500 years before Christ said, "Because it is sometimes so unbelievable, the truth escapes becoming known."
The answer to all this and the clue to this cosmic riddle may be found in the ancient book of Genesis. And back there in chapter 6, we are told of a very amazing and bizarre event. The sons of God saw the daughters of men and saw that they were beautiful, and they lusted after them. And then we read they married them and sired children from them. For the past 1,500 years, most scholars, including evangelical scholars, have interpreted the sons of God as the good sons of Seth and the daughters of men as the wicked daughters of Cain. They've adopted that interpretation because the other one is so bizarre and outlandish. The ancient interpretation, and in my opinion the correct one, is that the sons of God were demonic beings or fallen angels, and that they came down to earth, they lusted after the daughters of men, they married them, and produce this amazing progeny, this hybrid progeny of the Nephilim. And the very word Nephilim does not mean giants. It comes from the root Nephal, fallen ones. The early Christian fathers in the first four centuries, men like Irenaeus, Tertullian, Ambrose, for 400 years they knew no other interpretation except that the sons of God were angelic beings. Josephus, the cosmopolitan Jewish historian, says the same thing. We read in the book of Job that when God laid the foundation of the earth, the sons of God shouted for joy. Obviously, the sons of God could not be human beings. Adam had not been created. If this was a case of just mixed marriages between good men and wicked women, it is surprising that God should have issued the fiat of judgment that he did. God took this stern action of wiping out the human race. Now, the only family that were left intact in order to re-establish, repopulate the new world was the family of Noah. Noah, we are told, was perfect in his generations. The word perfect does not mean, in this case, morally perfect. Because we know from the story of Noah, and especially what happened after the flood, that Noah was not perfect. What it means is like a lamb for the paschal sacrifice, that lamb had to be without blemish, physically pure, without blemish. So it seems with the case of Noah, the only family that remained uncontaminated from these strange beings that appeared from space. The only line that was pure and clean from God's standpoint to start a new world and a new civilization. Jesus said, "As in the days of Noah, so in the days of the coming of the Son of Man." Of all the patriarchs and prophets of the Old Testament, the key to prophecy above all others, is Noah. And something happened in the days of Noah that was a distinctive characteristic of Noah's time that didn't happen before or after. Wars and famines and pestilences and natural disasters have always happened. But something happened in the days of Noah, and the most sinister and bizarre of all the things that happened was this intermarriage between the angelic race and the human race. And of course, the mastermind behind it all was another angel, a fallen angel, Lucifer. Now, we believe that as they came in those days, we may very well be on the edge of another invasion from outer space, that Satan will once again make another attempt, maybe the final assault on the human race, in order to wean men and women away from the worship of God. He has tried before, he will inevitably try again. And by seducing the human race, by sending these so-called entities from space, demonic beings, he will try to get people all over the world to worship him and to deprive God of the worship that is due to him. Fortunately, we know what the end result is going to be. But this final or omega assault that will come at the end of time may trigger the coming back of Jesus Christ to rescue his own. Satan has failed before, and the Bible predicts he will fail again. We are told quite emphatically in God's word that the kingdoms of this world shall become the kingdom of our God and of his Christ. Satan will make the attempt, but our God, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world.